So this is the next chapter of the three orders in the 11th class history series. Talking about the contents, the introduction, feudalism, the three orders, clergy, nobility and the peasants, manorial state, knights, monks, environment, crisis of the 14th century and the political changes also. Talking about the introduction, the socio-economic and the political changes occurred in the Western Europe between 9th and 16th century, and the third order focus on the three social categories, Christian priests, land-owning nobles, peasants, changing relationship between these three groups. Talking about the feudalism, the term feudalism is being used by the historian to describe the economic, legal, political and social relationship that existed in Europe in the medieval era. Feudalism is a Germanic word, feud means a piece of land. And it refers to a kind of society, France, then later England and southern Italy. In economic sense, it refers to a kind of agricultural production which is based on the relationship between the lords and the peasants. So this is a hierarchical picture of a feudal society, king, noble, lords, knights, peasants and serfs. Talking about the three orders, the French priests believed in their concept that the people were the members of the three orders depending on their work. The three orders of the society were clergy, nobility and peasantry. Talking about the first order, that is clergy, the Catholic Church had its own laws, own land given it by the rulers and could levy taxes also. The Christians in the Europe were guided by the bishops and the clerics who constituted the first order. And most of the villages had their own church where people assembled on the Sunday together to listen to the priest and to pray together. Women could not become priests and men who become priests could not marry. The use of the term Lord for God is taken from the feudal elite. Talking about the second order, that is nobility. The priest placed themselves in the first order and nobles in the second. The big landowners, the nobles, were the vassals of the king, and the peasants were the vassals of the landowners. The nobles was the lord of the people who is settled in his land, and noble's house was called the manor. His private land was cultivated by the peasants. So talking about the third order, that is peasants, cultivators were of two kinds, free peasants and the serfs. Free peasants held their farm as a tenant of the lord, and the men had to render military service at least 40 days every year. The peasants would be required to do any unpaid labor services like digging ditches, gathering firewood, building fences and repairing roads and buildings. There was one direct tax called the taille that king sometimes imposed on peasants. Talking about the manorial estate, a lord his own manor house, he also controlled villages, some lord controlled 100 of villages where peasants lived. A small manorial estate could contain a dozen families, while the larger estate might include 50 to 60 families. Almost everything needed for the daily life was found on the estate. Grain was grown in the field, blacksmiths and the carpenters maintained the lord's implement and repaired his weapons, while his stone mansion looked after his building. Women spun and wove fabrics, and children worked in the lord's fine presses. So this is a manorial system picture where you could find a spring planting field, fallow fields, meadows, blacksmith, well oven, lord's manor house, forest, and all dwellings which is needed in a manorial system. Talking about the knights, from the 9th century, there were frequent localized war in Europe. The amateur peasant soldiers were not sufficient and good cavalry was needed. They were linked to the lords just as the latter were linked to the king. The lord gave the knight a piece of land called fief and promised to protect it. In France, from the 12th century, the minstrel traveled from manor to manor singing songs which told stories, partly historical, partly invented, about brave kings and the knights. It extended to anything between 1,000 to 2,000 acres. Or more, including a house for the knight and his family, and a church or other establishment to house his independence, besides a watermill and a wine press. Talking, up, Talking about the monks, they lived in the religious communities called the abbeys or the monasteries, often in place very far from human habitation. Two of the more well-known monasteries were those established by Saint Benedict in Italy in 529 and of the Cluny in Burgundy in 910. Men became monks and women nuns. Like priests, monks and nuns did not marry. They contributed to the development of the art and the society. Talking about the environment, from the 5th to the 10th century, most of the Europe was covered with vast forests. The land available for agriculture was limited. From the 11th century, Europe entered a warm phase. Average temperature increased, which had a profound effect on the agriculture. Crisis of the 14th century. By the early 14th century, Europe's economic expansion slowed down. In 13th century, the warm summer of the previous year had given way to bitterly cold summers, and season for growing crops were reduced by a month. The ships came with a rat carrying the deadly bubonic plague in the infection Black Death, and the serious imbalances were created between agriculture and the manufacturer. Talking about the political changes, the development in the political sphere were parallel to the social process in the 15th and 16th century. The emergence of the triumvirate rules in the Europe was stimulated by the social changes of the 13th and 14th century as the feudal system weakened. Both the powerful new states and the economic changes that were occurring were significant for Europe, and the historian called these kings the new monarchs. The king like Louis XI in the France, Maximilian in the Austria, Henry VII in England, and Isabel and Ferdinand in Spain were the absolute monarchs. They started the process of organizing a standing army of 100 places.